Hey everyone, it's Tom Kradza with another Rockstar Minute. And does the government even care about real estate prices? We have three exhibits here for you. Exhibit A, Exhibit B, and Exhibit C over here. And I want to break this down. And the reason I want to break this down is because we're seeing multiple offer situations and real estate prices climb all over the city. And I know there's going to be a lot of debate whether that will continue or not continue. We're having that debate ourselves. But I just want to break down this idea about the government actually caring about real estate prices. So stick with me here. On Exhibit A, on why I think they do not care about real estate prices. Exhibit A, we have population growth in Ontario has been greater than housing supply for over a decade. We'll put up some stats here. Actually, we'll put up the first things, a Toronto Star article showing that Toronto itself is the fastest growing metropolitan center in North America. We've been talking about this for years, and now the Toronto Star is publishing this stuff. And we'll also show you some population data that has shown how the greater Toronto area has grown by over 1 million, about 1.2 million from 2011 to 2021 is the forecast, about 1.2 million. That means there's an extra 500,000 family formations happening here in the Greater Toronto area. So when the population grows that fast, and we have 500,000 family formations, or about 50,000 a year happening over the last 10 years, and then housing supply is only about 36,000 on average a year, and we'll share some stats from, I think it's Construct Connect or Canada Construct Connect. We'll have all the URLs that we're sharing here for all these images in the description of this video. How's that? When they've assembled the CMHC data, and it shows that we have about a housing supply of about 36,000 a year. So if we have 50,000 family formations a year and housing supply formation or creation of about 36,000, that's a delta or difference of 14,000 shortfall a year for 10 years. So we have an epic distortion here between population growth and housing supply. And I want to show you one more forecast from the province of Ontario on what the population forecast they're anticipating looks like. Take a look at this chart. And I know a lot of people are kind of concerned on what's going on with the whole COVID situation. Will immigration continue? We believe over the next few years, it's absolutely going to continue because the government wants it to continue. So there might be a brief pause right now, which we can totally handle, of course, but it's going to continue. So the next thing on Exhibit A is low interest rates for greater than 10 years. Take a look at this chart of the Bank of Canada rates for the last 10 years. Now, there was a financial situation in 2007 and 2008 which kind of caused all this, but interest rates have been way too low for too long, and when you have cheap money, it drives hard asset prices like real estate. So we have had low rates for over a decade. So that's Exhibit A, that's kind of our standard stuff. Now I want to take you over to Exhibit B on why I think the government does not care about real estate prices. Check this out. They recently announced mortgage changes in Canada, but I would call them very weak mortgage changes. And those went into effect on July 1st, 2020. But the reason I would call them very weak is some of the changes around credit scores, they changed the credit score that is required to get a CMHC-insured mortgage for first-time buyers who are putting like less than 20% down, or insured mortgages, people who are buying properties with insurance from CMHC, from 600 to 680. 680 was already what I thought a good credit score was. I didn't know they had reduced it to 600. So they're bringing it back to 680, which is kind of the low entry for what I was always told was good credit. So the credit score change is kind of weak. It's just bringing it back to what good credit was. I had already assumed where it was actually. And then the debt ratios. The debt ratio change on the calculation is really minor. It's not that big of a change. So when you have credit score changes and debt ratio changes that are kind of minor, they're weak mortgage changes. And on top of that, there's more than one insurer in Canada. These changes were just made by CMHC. There's two other mortgage insurers in Canada. And the other mortgage insurers haven't made these changes. So these mortgage change announcements are kind of weak when it's CMHC has made the changes, but you can go to two other mortgage insurers and get the old rules. So that's why I would call it really weak. It makes for a great headline, and the government can come out and say, hey, look what we're doing for real estate. We're making these changes, but that's kind of weak stuff. If they really wanted to make a big change, how about increasing down payments? Because how about they say, hey, we can't raise interest rates because we have way too much debt. We've run deficits for too long. We can't raise interest rates, but we can cool the real estate market in one way. We can increase down payments. We can move them from 5% for first-time home buyers or insured mortgages up to 10. We can move non-insured mortgages minimum from 20 to maybe 25, 30. That's definitely one way to change the real estate market. But never anyone is talking about that kind of stuff. But that would be a serious way to change the real estate market, changing down payments. That's never discussed. And maybe in the future it will be, but it's never discussed. And then variable rates this spring were cut. So interest rates went down a full point and a half. You can get variable rate mortgages right now in Canada for under 2%. And fixed rates are really low. Nick and I just redid a mortgage on one of our investment properties. We got a fixed rate for, let me get this straight. Sorry, this was a variable rate. We got a variable rate for 2.03, if you can believe it. It's prime minus 0.43, if I have that right. 0.42, prime minus 0.42. We got a prime mortgage for 2.03. But some of the fixed rate mortgage promotions that we saw in the spring were 1.99% on a 5-year fixed. So you're getting a 5-year fix from anywhere from like 1.99 to 2.5. So both variable rates and fixed rates are super low. So that's exhibit B on why we think the government doesn't care about real estate prices, because when you have all this stuff in place, I mean, some of this stuff makes for good headlines, but it's not really going to be a big dramatic change to the real estate market, not in our opinion anyway. And so exhibit C, this is probably my favorite exhibit over here. Exhibit C is that in Canada, the Bank of Canada, our central bank, says they operate with a 2% inflation target, meaning that prices can only go up in the country 2% a year. That's their target, right? The thing is, they're never really accurate with this thing, and they run a substitution model. We'll put up a white paper from the Bank of Canada, and remember, the links to all this stuff are in the description of this video. But the substitution model says, well, if prices for like coffee go up really high, higher than 2%, in our calculations that year, we'll just substitute coffee with tea. But you know, there's people like me that if I want my coffee, I want my coffee. I don't want to drink my tea. I want coffee. But they don't take that in the calculation. Or they'll use examples like this, that if beef goes up too much, they'll just substitute it with chicken in their calculations, because, you know, if you were gonna buy beef and it's too expensive, you might just buy chicken instead, right? Before, they used to use examples of like steak and hot dogs. Like, you know, if steak goes up, maybe you'll buy a hot dog. If I want a steak. So they play with this number, which doesn't make any sense to me. It's actually like outright lying. Let's just all speak openly about what this is. But that's a substitution model. That's the language that they use for it. And then in real estate, to bring this to real estate hasn't gone up 2% a year. So when we did some analysis on the Toronto Real Estate Board from 1974 until I think it was last year, it was going up over 6% a year, compounded. 6% a year, triple the target, triple. Another reason we think that the government does not care about stable real estate prices. And then on the Bank of Canada's website, we see white papers like this. This one just came out earlier this year. And we'll put it up on the screen for you, but it has the words helicopter money in it. And it's hilarious because in this white paper on the Bank of Canada, they're arguing if they should print more money and stick it into the economy, or if it's better if the government runs deficits and borrows money from the bond market. What's the better way to stimulate the economy? How about this? How about we just save money? How about we save money as a country and only spend what we save? How about that? That's not discussed in the central bank's white paper. In fact, that's not even mentioned at all. It's really just a discussion on one bad way versus another bad way. So, you know, that's another reason we think they don't care about real estate prices, because when you just put more and more money into the economy, things like hard assets, like real estate, tend to go up really quickly. And the other thing is that it's unsound money forever. Government money is unsound, meaning that there's no limit to it. They can just print as much as they want. And the federal budget deficits for 2020 finally came out, because we've all been guessing as Canadians, how much money have we really been spending on all this stimulus that we've been putting in through this COVID situation? Well, take a look at the chart that we have up on the screen right now. There's our budget deficits, and it looks like the forecast going forward is even higher. How are we going to backtrack out of all of this if we haven't even seen the economic data come out from corporations in the private sector about what's happened in Q2 of this year? When that starts rolling out later this year, aren't we going to have to do more stimulus to offset that? I mean, time will tell. But it feels like to us that it's just unsound money forever. And on top of this, what is very rarely discussed is that our current money system requires more money in the system, and it requires that people take mortgages, because that's how money is actually created in our system. I have a white paper that is linked off the top of my profile on Twitter. My Twitter handle is @TomKaradza. If you go there, you'll see that white paper. The white paper is from the Bank of England, but it's describing how all these central banks create money. Just look at page one of that white paper, and it'll describe to you exactly how money is created in this world. And it's for these reasons that we believe that the government does not care about the state of real estate prices. When you have all of this stuff happening over years and decades, it seems pretty obvious to us that although sometimes they make announcements that will make for good headlines, in the grand scheme of things, they don't care if real estate prices keep going up and that if the average person is having a harder and harder time to pay their rent and to buy properties. Our 2 cents only, I guess that's 4 cents if I put up two twos like that, our 2 cents only. Hopefully that gave you something to think about. Until next time, your life, your terms.